Now, let's introduce the formal definition of an optimal policy. When we discussed the state value in the previous lecture, we emphasized repeatedly that the state value is important because it could be used to evaluate if a policy is good or not. So, let's formalize this idea. Suppose we have two policies, Pi1 and Pi2, each with its own state values. If for every state S, the state value for Pi1 is greater than that for Pi2, then we say that Pi1 is better than Pi2. Further, we can define what is optimal. A policy Pi star is optimal if it achieves greater state value than any other policy Pi for any given state. These definitions seem straightforward, but after presenting them, we need to address a series of questions. For instance, does the optimal policy exist? It might seem unrealistic that such a policy outperforms all other policies across every state. Is it possible that a policy can only outperform others in some states but not in others? This leads us to our first question. The second question is about the uniqueness of the policy. Is the optimal policy unique, or could there be multiple optimal policies? The third question is the optimal policy stochastic or deterministic? Sometimes we prefer deterministic policies for which, in a given state, it's definite which action should be taken. So, is the optimal policy stochastic or deterministic? Another important question is how to obtain the optimal policy. To answer these questions, we need to study the Bellman optimality equation, which allows us to address all these questions clearly. Now, let's formally introduce the Bellman optimality equation. Our approach is to directly present this equation and then analyze its properties in detail. This equation might look very familiar to you. It's essentially the Bellman equation, which is defined for a given policy pi. However, there's a slight modification, the addition of max before pi, making pi no longer given. This introduces an optimization problem within the equation. We need to first solve pi and then substitute it back into the equation. This is the Bellman optimality equation. I know you may have many questions in your mind now, including how to solve for pi and so on. Don't worry, we'll answer all these questions in detail. The complex term on the right can be simply expressed as QSA. What do we know and what are we aiming to solve? We know the probabilities corresponding to the system's model, the reward, and the discount rate gamma. What we aim to solve is the value of V. Is pi known or unknown here? In the Bellman equation, the policy is given beforehand. However, in the Bellman optimality equation, pi is not given. We must solve it. We've already transitioned from the element-wise form to the matrix vector form, a process I won't detail here, as it was thoroughly explained when we introduced the Bellman equation. The only difference here is the addition of max pi, which applies to a vector, and we can move max pi inside the parentheses. This is the Bellman optimality equation. It is tricky, yet elegant. Why elegant? Because its expression is very concise and it describes the optimal policy and optimal state value in an elegant way. Why tricky? On one hand, there is a maximization on the right-hand side. On the other hand, it may not be straightforward to see how to solve it. Now, I'm sure you have many questions about the Bellman equation in your mind. No need to worry. We'll address them one by one. First, I'll show how to solve this equation, then whether a solution exists and if it's unique. I'll also explain why we study this equation and its relationship with optimal policy and optimal state value. All these questions will be answered in this lecture. We've just provided the expression for the Bellman optimality equation. Now let's delve into a detailed analysis of this equation. The first aspect I'll discuss may be confusing, the maximization on the right-hand side. Specifically, this is the element-wise form of the Bellman optimality equation, and this is its matrix vector form. As we can see, there is a maximization on the right-hand side, which might be confusing to beginners. For instance, in this equation, we have an unknown quantity, V. Even though V is a vector, we simply treat it as an unknown. Besides this unknown, we also need to solve pi. For every state, we must identify the optimal pi. This means that we have one equation, but need to solve two unknowns. How can this be done? It's actually quite simple. Let me illustrate with an example. Consider two variables, x and a, satisfying this equation. This equation is designed to mimic the Bellman optimality equation. It also involves solving for the optimization on the right-hand side. How do we solve this equation? Actually, we divide it into two parts. First, consider the right-hand side of the equation. What's on the right-hand side of the equation? It's this. What is its optimal value? It's actually quite obvious because it involves the square of a. It reaches its maximum value when a equals 0. Then, it's 2x minus 1. If a is not 0, because this term is negative, this value will certainly be smaller. So, the right-hand side yields an optimal value of 2x minus 1, and this optimal value can be achieved when a equals 0. What is the second step? The second step is to substitute this optimal value, where a equals 0, back into the right-hand side. Then the right-hand side actually becomes 2x minus 1, and the left-hand side is x. This is very easy to solve, and we know the solution is x equals 1. So, by these two steps, we have obtained the solution as a equals 0 and x equals 1. This idea can be applied to solving the Bellman optimality equation. First, look at the right-hand side of the Bellman equation. This term and this term are fixed. This is an unknown term. For any value of this term, we can abbreviate it as QSA. Inspired by the previous example, we need to determine pi SA. Here we have multiple actions. In our grid world, we have a total of 5 actions, from QSA1, QSA2, to QSA5. Now that I have these 5 values, how do I solve pi? Let's demonstrate with another example. Consider a simple case where we have 3 Q values, and our task is to find the coefficients that maximize an objective function under the constraint that their sum equals 1 and each value is no negative. This constraint is important because these coefficients correspond to probabilities whose sum equals 1. What's the optimal value here? Let's assume there's a maximum among Q1, Q2, and Q3, for instance. Q3 is the largest. It is totally all right to assume that Q1 or Q2 is the largest. If Q3 is the largest, the optimal solution would be C3 equals 1, while C1 and C2 equals 0. Why? There are two ways to explain. Intuitively, C3 represents the weight of Q3. Since Q3 is the maximum, we want to allocate all weight to Q3, naturally making C3 equal to 1 to maximize the overall sum. From a mathematical point of view, this can also be easily explained. Let's look at this equation. First, on the left is Q3, then Q3 equals C1 plus C2 plus C3 times Q3. Since these added together equal 1, and when we expand it, we can get C1Q3, C2Q3, C3Q3. Because Q3 is the largest, it is greater than the others. Therefore, it must be greater than or equal to C1Q1 plus C2Q2 plus C3Q3. So, looking from the far left is Q3, and the far right is such a sum, which means Q3 is greater than all. Regardless of the values taken by C1, C2, and C3, Q3 is always greater than or equal to them. This clearly corresponds to the situation where C3 equals 1, so, we know its optimal solution should be C3 equals 1. This approach can also be applied to solving the Bellman optimality equation. From the example above, we now see how to solve the optimal pi when the value of q on the right-hand side is fixed. The ultimate result is that the optimal value on the left equals the largest of the q value. When does it equal the maximum q value? The selection of pi should be such that for a star it equals 1, and for actions not a star it is 0. Here, a star corresponds to the action associated with the highest Q value. Through this introduction, we have clearly demonstrated how to handle the potentially confusing optimization problem on the right.